Why do you have so much gas, loose stools, bloating, or abdominal pains? And why isn't that prescription medication or that probiotic working out for you? Well, today I'm going to talk about the major steps in digestion and where things frequently go wrong. And hopefully I'll give you some steps that you can take to get your digestive system working better. And what's up everybody, CW here from Considerate Health, where I consider some of the big topics in health today. And today's topic is digestion. So many people have problems with their digestion, whether it be the occasional heartburn or the chronic loose stools and bloating. Now, many digestive issues fall into one of two categories, problems with digestion and problems with absorption. Today we're going to be talking specifically about problems with digestion, and we'll save the absorption for another video. But what's the major difference? Digestion is the breakdown of nutrients like fats, carbs, and proteins into a small enough size so that your body can actually absorb them. Absorption, on the other hand, is actually taking those broken down nutrients through the intestinal lining into circulation where then your body's cells can actually utilize those nutrients. Now, one of the most common mistakes that patients and clinicians even make is that they oftentimes start too far downstream. So for example, someone with intestinal bloating oftentimes may benefit from probiotics, but they may only see limited benefit because the major problem is actually higher up, for example, in the stomach or even in the mouth. So speaking of mouth, let's begin there. The mouth is where digestion actually begins and is so often overlooked. The mouth is unique in the sense that it's the only part of digestion where it's under your voluntary control. After you swallow your food, in a sense, everything's almost automatic. Now, the major players in your mouth include your teeth, your salivary glands, and your tongue. Now, we normally start digestion by mechanically breaking down our food by chewing with our teeth. This also increases surface area where enzymes can coat and actually start breaking down our food chemically as well. Now, the salivary glands secrete an enzyme that starts breaking down our carbohydrates, and our tongue also makes an enzyme that will get activated later on in the stomach that starts breakdown of fats. So let's pause there to discuss some of the common problem areas with the mouth, starting with the teeth. Now, if you can't or don't chew your food well, you're already putting your digestion at a disadvantage. Those salivary enzymes I just mentioned, if they can't properly coat and start the breakdown process chemically, the rest of your digestive system further down is going to have to work that much harder to break down those food particles. So if you have problems with your dentition, your missing teeth, or having damaged teeth, try to get that taken care of by a dentist if you can, because it's going to affect your digestion. Now, what if you don't chew your food well? Now, there may be multiple reasons, but one big reason is people just tend to eat too fast. They tend to bite and then just swallow and inhale their food. There's some studies that show that the average person only chews 6 to 10 times per bite of food. That's not much. The ideal may be closer to about 30 to 40 bites per food, of course, depending on what the food is. So chew your food well. Now, there's another problem oftentimes with people that tend to eat too fast or inhale their food is that they tend to swallow more air. Now, this can already cause problems with more gas, more bloating, and even reflux. Then there are issues with saliva. There are medical conditions or medications that tend to give people more dry mouth. And of course, this will impair the whole salivary process. So products that help moisten the mouth may be a benefit here. And if you haven't already clicked that like button and subscribed and hit that notification bell, please do so. It will help my channel out a lot. So once you swallow, the involuntary part of digestion begins. The food moves from your mouth through your esophagus and into your stomach, where it's highly acidic. The stomach makes hydrochloric acid, which not only kills microbes, but also denatures or unfolds proteins so that another enzyme, which the stomach also makes, called pepsin, starts breaking down those proteins into smaller chunks. Now, that other enzyme I mentioned earlier, lingual lipase, now is activated in the stomach, and that starts breaking down the fats. Your stomach itself also makes an enzyme that starts breaking down fats. So there's one more role the acidic environment of the stomach plays, and that is the stimulation of the flow of bile and pancreatic juices, which are so important and which we're going to see very shortly. So what often goes wrong here in the stomach? And I'll say one of the most common is alteration of the stomach's pH or the stomach's acidity. If you're one of the millions who regularly takes antacids like Tums or Rolaids or prescription ones like H2 blockers or PPIs, unfortunately you are altering your digestion and impairing your digestion. And you've heard me say earlier how important stomach acid is actually for denaturing proteins, and pepsin, which actually breaks down those proteins, is actually inactivated at a higher pH. pH. So by throwing antacids in there, you may actually be impairing your digestion. Also, like I said, it may also impair your pancreatic flow and bile flow later on because of the more alkaline pH of the stomach. But you might say, CW, I have really bad heartburn or GERD, so I have to take those antacids. I totally sympathize with that, and hopefully in the future, I'll make a video on GERD itself and talk about a better way and more holistic way of managing a condition like that. But you may say, hey, none of these situations really apply to me. Well, just keep in mind that as people age, oftentimes our stomach acid may actually decrease over time, so your digestion may actually be impaired. So in all these cases, there are times where someone may actually need supplemental betaine with hydrochloride with pepsin. You can actually supplement that, or digestive bitters. So after a few hours, the food exits the stomach and enters the first part of the small intestine. And this is where the gallbladder and the pancreas come into play. The gallbladder releases bile, and this emulsifies fats, which means it breaks it up into smaller globules so that the digestive enzymes can actually work on it. And the digestive enzymes are released by the pancreas, and the pancreas releases these enzymes that break down not just the fats, but also the carbs and the protein. So what can go wrong here? Surprisingly to a lot of people, this is actually one of the most underlooked areas in digestion, which is gallbladder sluggishness or gallbladder sludge. And this affects certain populations more than others, especially women in their childbearing years that are heavier set and from certain ethnicities. But it can affect people from other demographics as well. So what happens, if you can imagine, the gallbladder's bile is basically thickened or kind of gunked up. So basically the flow is not as good. And what can happen then is because the fats are not digested as well downstream, then you'll have more symptoms like diarrhea. Now, many people may have had their gallbladders removed and told it's not really going to affect your digestion later on, because what's really making the bile is not the gallbladder. The gallbladder is just a storage tank. The liver is the one that actually makes the bile, and that gets stored in the gallbladder, and then of course the gallbladder squeezes when the food comes down. But the problem is, even if the gallbladder is removed, the coordination now between the liver and when the food coming into the small intestine sometimes isn't exactly as good as it was when someone had a gallbladder. And so some people can still experience a lot of digestive symptoms without their gallbladder. So when someone's digestive issues pertain to the gallbladder, there may be appropriate times where the supplements like turmeric and D-limonene and ox bile extract actually may be helpful for cases like that. How about the pancreas? Well, actually a big subset of our population may have some degree of pancreatic insufficiency. Those with diabetes, which is a chronic condition in our society today, up to 40% of them, type 1 and type 2 diabetics, have some degree of impaired pancreatic function. And this, of course, can cause digestive issues downstream. And you can just imagine, if your pancreas isn't working well, what can happen? If you can't break down your food, your fats, your carbs, your proteins, then downstream you're gonna have more likelihood to have bloating and have diarrhea and things like that. And it's not just diabetics, this includes others with Crohn's disease, celiac disease, those with heavy alcohol use. So this is something to be aware of as well. And in those cases, oftentimes there may be appropriate supplements like digestive enzymes that may help. But of course, you always want to address the underlying issue as well. And last but not least, we come to the small intestine itself. Now, at this point, most of the digestion has already happened and some absorption has also been going on as well. But the small intestine itself along the walls have what they call brush border enzymes. And these help break down sugars like sucrose and lactose so that your body can absorb them. And there's even some breakdown of protein products as well. So what can go wrong here in the small intestines? Well, in essence, anything that damages the small intestinal wall will have effects on your digestion downstream. So we have our usual culprits like Crohn's disease and celiac disease, and those things affect the gut microvilli. But we also have common issues like leaky gut, also known as intestinal permeability or intestinal hyperpermeability in the literature. And that basically, again, damages the small intestinal linings. So you can imagine, if that very last bit of digestion is not occurring very well, you can have, again, a lot of those symptoms, including the bloating, the chronic diarrhea, the abdominal pains, and things like that. And one other factor that can affect the small intestinal walls is gut dysbiosis, or bacterial imbalance. And this oftentimes can damage the small intestinal walls. And I think this is where oftentimes probiotics may be of help, even though probiotics typically more target the large intestine than the small intestine. But that is a factor as well. And whew, we made it through digestion. Hopefully you were able to digest that material I told you and absorb some of it. Now, I know I raised a lot of issues today, and if you have any questions, leave me a comment below, so I would love to try to answer that for you. But until the next time, be well.